March meeting of the Rollinsford Planning Board. And tonight we have a special guest that's gonna give us some valuable information. So I don't know if you,
I was at another event.
Busy night in town, like two things happening. So I just called the meeting. You didn't miss anything. So I don't know if you wanna take it from here or.
Sure, hi Sarah, John Ray.
Hi, nice to meet you.
This is my last copy.
Cool, thank you.
John had gotten in touch with me, a couple weeks ago and said, let's put something together for training, and so we exchanged a couple notes. And the notes got transformed into basically, you know, about 13 or 14 points. And so this is like the chronology of, you know, of a meeting, you know, of an application. So I thought we just, that would be a logical way to set it up.
That's great.
And the key, I think, is you guys interrupt and ask me questions anytime because we don't want to lose the thread, you know. And so, you know, the first thing, and it's interesting because sometimes you'll get some debate about what the role of the planner is or what the role of the planning board is. And both the Constitution and case law require planning boards to assist applicants, you know. So you're kind of unlike the zoning board. The zoning board is like, you know, they're a judicial board. You know, they wear invisible black robes and they provide no assistance to the applicant. Whereas, and not supposed to, whereas the planning board is supposed to. But really, you know, by the time you get to deliberation or the time you get to the public hearings, it's really, at that point, there is some more separation of distance, you know. By the time you've had a public hearing or two and a thing, oftentimes you'll have formed a pretty good opinion about, you know, what the plan has and what it's lacking. And so lots of times get assistance in the form of telling people that, you know, by the way, you've got to attend to this, 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 and this. So the planning board's a helping board, and you've got a planner, which really helps. And so the planner's really kind of your agent.
One of the things that a lot of people ask me, the first question I get typically from an applicant is, what is this board like? and you know, having worked all over Rockingham County and Southern New Hampshire for, I don't know, the better part of 20 years, what John was saying is, it sounds stupid, it sounds pretty simple, but it's not what happens in a lot of towns. And I can't tell you how many towns that an applicant strolls in the door, you know, goes to a planning board meeting, and all of a sudden it's like, it's not, there's no attempt to assist the plan, the applicant through the process.
Think of a seacoast town that has a three-letter word.
Starting with.
Yeah, we
starting with. Right? And I've worked for that town, both as for the planner, and I've taken projects through on the other side, and I can tell you it's brutal. It's, you know, everything is called into question. Everything is, regulations are open to interpretation to try to, you know, to submarine a project. And that's not the intent. The intent is to say, let's do this, we can get you through that way. It doesn't mean you have to do stuff for people, but you need to guide them through the process in a helpful manner. And I tell everybody, the worst thing about the Rollinsford Planning Board is that you don't have experience. And it's not because you haven't been on the board 9 years collectively here, both of you, but we don't get a lot of applications.
Right.
You know, what do we get? Maybe a two-lot subdivision. The last site plan I can remember is Cumberland Farms. I don't know. We don't get a lot. So it's not, if you were on the Dover Planning Board, in 1 year you'd have more experience than you would have in this board, or this board in 10 years. Mm. It doesn't make you a bad board. It makes you a good board that just doesn't see a lot. And when we get something, sometimes we stumble.
Right.
So, sorry, John.
That's all right.
But I do think you're a helpful board, and I've never seen any attempt to stop a project or to kill it by just throwing roadblocks in someone's way. So.
And you guys got rules of procedure, right?
Yep.
And rules of procedure generally kind of lay out board proceeds through meetings. Are they up on the website?
I don't think so.
Yeah, you asked me that email, and I didn't.
If you can, it's useful to put them up. You know, the first time a meeting is shown up, you might not know what happens. But if you looked at the rules of procedure before the first time you showed up, you'd say, oh, yeah, the order of things is this, you know, the applicant speaks first, then the people of this, and, you know. And that can provide a level of familiarity that, you know, good people.
That's a great suggestion.
And, you know, so then sometimes, you know, the third thing I know is board, you know, board member conflicts of interest disqualification. This is usually pretty straightforward stuff. I mean, if you're in a buyer.
Writing course, training, training, oh.
If you've got a familial, you know, direct personal or financial interest, you know, if your business partner's making the application, or if it's your second cousin making the application, then those are things for you to use yourself. If, and I think people are usually pretty good about that. If people have, you know, prejudged the application in the sense that you're really confirming convinced that this is something that, you know, should be going forward, then the thing to do is to step down. You really only hear about the prejudgment cases when, for instance, I had a guy in Londonderry who campaigned against this project, against the project that a client of mine was putting forward, which had already been before the planning board. And then he was running for town council. And so, lo and behold, he got appointed as the council representative for the planning board. And it didn't recuse himself. Like, what? You know? And there was actually YouTube videos of him campaigning on this stuff. So it's not like, you know, there could be any dispute as to what happened.
So if I knew that about Kevin, for example, is it up to me to say, I think you should recuse yourself, or is it entirely up to him to?
Well, the way the statute works is members can suggest, you know, and also members can take a non-binding vote and ask someone to recuse themselves. But at the end of the day, it's up to Kevin. And if he doesn't want to step down, even though he's been encouraged to, you can't force him to step down.
Oh, okay.
I mean, there have been instances where I've written rather stern letters when someone's informed me what the conflict was, and I said, you know, you step down. And I've never had someone who didn't step down when the board as a whole got that first stern letter. But it was really something, it was very egregious and very clear, you know.
Where it gets a little bit grayer is when your partner has taken a position. And we don't get a lot of controversial projects here, but the last big one was like the Fails Only subdivision. And I can't remember if we had any issues there, but let's just say your wife in the paper was saying, I think this is a stupid project. You know, we got to do whatever we're going to kill. That's where it gets a little bit gray, you know.
But I
still think you have your own mind.
Yeah, exactly.
You didn't say anything. You're fine to but it can be gray.
Right. And I've had people ask people to recuse themselves, you know. And, you know, when those facts are brought to my attention, usually half the time, there's no basis for the recusal, you know.
I do wish John was here, because we had an issue with John at a couple of meetings ago. Because John Hinsman also sits on the zoning board.
Right.
And a lot, yes. There has been at least one case where he feels uncomfortable sitting on an application knowing it's going to go to the zoning board.
Yeah.
That was the
LaVoy subdivision.
And we didn't know how to handle that.
Yeah, well, I
and we didn't need his vote anyway, but.
Right. I think the way to handle something like that is, you know, you're making a decision oftentimes where is it more necessary that I participate? Because if he's on the zoning board and gets involved in the issue that then gets appealed administratively to the, if he's on the planning board and gets appealed to the zoning board, he's got to step down, you know. Whereas, unless he didn't participate at the local level, you know, at the planning board level,
okay.
He could participate. But by the same token, he might say, you know, it's hard for us to get it, you know, the membership goes from 5 down to 4. If I'm not there, people should have a full board. And there's an alternate on the planning board, so I'm going to set aside. And I think you can play that either way. It just depends on, you know.
But I think speaking on the side of asking someone or how you approach someone that you feel they should recuse themselves. John, as we're talking about, clearly at every moment stated, I'm not participating in this vote. Anytime the vote passed him, it was very clear.
Sure.
And you could also talk about the situation where board members up front disclose that they don't want to participate.
Right.
And at that point, there's,
and I don't think
that's his own, that's a choice he has. And,
yeah, and I don't think people have to explain themselves. You know,
yeah, exactly.
Either, you know, I mean, you know, it could be simply that it's a good friend from church or from the Boy Scouts or the Girl Scouts, where you just feel uncomfortable, you know, having to do your job and maybe make a vote that would be, you know, adverse to them. And in a small town, those things come up.
In those situations where, as John disclosed right up front at every opportunity he got to speak, his reasoning is really his own. Whether he wants to vote for other reasons because he may have been a butter or not, which I don't believe he is in this case, but not necessarily because he sat on another board which might review the project.
Right.
But like I said, John, right out the gate, to my recollection.
Yep. And then,
always
and then,
clearly said for the record.
Yeah, and then when once you do that, you go sit out there.
Oh, really? Okay.
Because I think it's good just because it gives you a separation. You know,
yeah.
We don't ask John to do that, it's, you know.
Right.
I'm picking on John because, you know, he's the one that did it.
Kevin's had to do it before.
Yeah, Kevin's had to, just sit there, that way there's no.
Right, okay.
Because I don't want Kevin saying, hey, put it on the table, you know.
Right, or just.
Or steering the discussion a different way.
Instinctively, when you're here, you're used to participating. You don't want to inadvertently open up your mouth and then, you know. So I always think it's a good thing just to sit there.
But not required.
No, no.
Because
not required.
As John is a resident of the town.
Right.
And it is a
no,
public
just
forum.
No, sit in the
audience. But he can still sit at the table.
I think it's a good idea.
I understand that you say it's a good idea.
Right.
But no, it's not a requirement.
No, it's not.
I think Miles, as chairman, can say, geez, you recuse yourself. I think it'd be good or better if you sat in the audience.
Hey, have a discussion.
Yeah.
You think that someone should sit in the audience? It's a procedure.
I don't think he would have had an issue with that. I just it didn't occur to me. But.
Right. So then we jumped to number four, application acceptance. So your jurisdiction begins when you take a vote that the application is complete. And I assume that works off of a checklist or an application or one of the things you want. Usually, waivers will not have been voted on at that point, but you usually don't say that an application is incomplete because they have a waiver request that covers the things they don't have. Usually it deals out of the waiver line. And then if you don't give them a waiver, then the application isn't complete. You know, they got to go get it.
There are towns, and I worked for the town of Wilkesboro for a half a year as their consultant while they were finding a planner, and they acted on the waivers before they accepted it, and I thought it was horribly awkward. Because
yeah.
you generally get a better feel for the application as you're reviewing it and to act, you know, to
of what you're going to need for waivers.
Absolutely.
Right?
Well, what you're needing and how you're going to treat them. I thought it was a horrible process. I didn't like it. Other towns do that, but I think I would say 95% of towns in New Hampshire accept. And then with the applicant knows they don't get the waiver. They don't have an application.
But I like the process that we have where the town comes to us for that discussion of whether to accept and complete. Generally, you've previewed this document, and that's the benefit of having a planner that participates so much.
I also tell the boards that I work with this, that when you say on the checklist, let's say they have a drainage analysis, it could be written on a piece of toilet paper worth nothing. If they have it, it's there. It says, you check the mark off. Yes, it's there. Now, when we go through the review, we're going to send it out and everything is going to be evaluated and say, okay, you submitted it, but it's worthless. There's one more thing that we need to talk about as a procedure because there was an error made on the last application and it has to do with this application acceptance. It's not always an issue, but in Rollinsford, I don't know who the zoning officer is. I think it's the selectman still.
The zoning officer?
Yeah.
Well, yes.
So in most towns, this is what happens. Somebody, either a board or a code enforcement officer, building inspector, decides whether or not something meets the requirements of the zoning ordinance before it goes to the planning board. In the case of the Blumenmill, it was my understanding that the zoning ordinance was changed, it wasn't changed the way I thought it was. After the project was approved by the planning board, it was determined that a special exception was needed. So I think going forward, in most cases, this is not an issue. If it's a two-lot subdivision, we all know what the zoning ordinance says. It's also been a little bit difficult in years past because, you know, like Pat Mack would make changes in zoning ordinance. Sometimes they happened, sometimes they didn't, it was always a little bit weird. But I think going forward, if there's any question, you gotta ask Tom and or the Board of Selectmen if there are any zoning issues before we proceed. Because I just don't want this happening again where we spend all this time doing this, and I don't think it's gonna be an issue, but now, after a planning board approval was granted, that they have to kiss it back to the zoning board for a special exception.
Which
I didn't think he needed, but I think he does. The way the zoning ordinance is worded now, I think he does. I thought it was changed, so he didn't need it.
That's the thing we got on the ballot last year to extend the enterprise zone or whatever we called it.
So at any rate, I think that's, and again, if 95% of our applications are straightforward, there's no zoning issues, it's not a big deal. But if there's any question, I think what we should do is, and I hate to slow things down, but to ask either Tom and or the Board of Selectmen to review the application to make sure it complies with the zoning ordinance. And I think we'll know when these things happen. I don't want to do it. I don't think a planner should do it. I think there needs to be a separation between zoning and planning. And I think John would concur.
Yeah, I think in most towns it's done either by the zoning enforcement, the code enforcement officer, or it's done by the building inspector. And that's a good practice. So, because it goes to the helping the applicant point of view.
Yep.
You're making sure that they have all the requirements in the zoning ordinance.
So we wouldn't put that on our agenda until we got that.
Again, if we're doing a two-lot subdivision, it's very easy.
Yeah.
This last one, it was an error, you know, on my part. It fell through the cracks. I'll take the blame. It doesn't really matter. There was an error made. I think where there's any question like that, we should ask for a clarification from Tom and Board.
Okay.
So as the procedure happens now, applications are pretty much given to Caroline, and then they're kind of forwarded to me. Do we want to start, and then I sort of disseminate it to the board?
I think they should go to Tom for a zoning review.
Okay.
You know, I mean, I don't know how many hours he can work, but we don't have that many applications.
No.
You know, if it's a home occupation, I don't think he's going to go. You know what? Because we don't have that many, I would just forward them all to him.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
He's not going to bombard him.
Right.
And just ask him to, you know, and all he needs to do is send a simple email to you and say, I reviewed the application, it complies with the zoning ordinance.
Okay.
Green light.
Alright.
I think that's a good
practice. So I'll forever bring this to the select board to make sure that we're okay with that. Okay. All of them going through. And we need to make sure we have enough hours.
I'm only simply saying that I just picked one out of the hat for the home occupation. All of a sudden, you know, someone could come in with a home occupation for an auto body shop, and it wouldn't be an allowed use. It would get on our agenda. So I think it would be cleaner to have him review every single application, and most of them are going to be probably a 10-minute review.
Yeah, it's going to be use issues. It's not going to be building height or dimensional issues, because those are all going to come up at the building permit stage, and they're not really on the plan.
Yep.
So, you know, going back to, so when you vote application acceptance, of course, that triggers the 65-day approval clock under the statute, and which is really not a big thing as long as you keep attention to the 65 days, because usually that gives you two meetings.
Yep.
You know, and then you get to the, you know, as long as you're within 65 days, you just ask the applicant to continue, and what are they going to say? No, you know, I want a decision out tonight, because that means, you know, you're not going to get an approval because we're not done with the review. So that's just a kind of a housekeeping issue. And then, you know, the statute requires you to do the development of regional impact analysis. You know, most of the stuff does not trigger that review. But if you have a big project or a project that's right on the town boundary, you know, big projects are gonna have traffic, they're gonna have school kids, then people still have school kids. School kids are actually a good thing now, because the class size in a lot of our schools. But, so really it's traffic and, it could be a large project near the boundary that, would trigger that. But the big thing to do is just make that part of your checklist that you do right after application acceptance. You ask John Cecil. And if in doubt, you declare a regional.
We had one in 10 years.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. But you're supposed to go through it, and so you just take a vote out. And then waivers, then you're at grant waivers. I agree that, I think the reason why you grant waivers after you accept the application is you haven't taken jurisdiction yet. So until you take jurisdiction, how the heck do you have the authority?
To take action.
To take action, you don't. So then you work, then you go on waivers. And then we're in a project review, and that's just, it's just the moving the application forward. With the assistance of your planner, if the application requires outside engineering review or, a wetland specialist at the applicant's expense, you engage those folks. I'm a big believer of doing that if the application is at all, complicated, and John would be able to advise you if this should go up for review or not. Because, especially if there are improvements, if someone's going to build a road, you want to make sure that the road engineer finds that all the numbers and, the locations and the station numbers and, all the drainage and all that stuff works. Because you don't want to hear about it from your road agent, 3 years later that it's not working.
Right.
And also the reviews by the engineer, create the checklist of issues that make your job really easy. You should get the first review letter, and then there's 8 items on it, and then you get the second review letter, and then there's 2 items on it and 2 comments, and then that sets you up to give an approval subject to satisfying the second review letter, and that's not really how those things go. If it ever gets to and also the review engineer and John are also suggesting to you, in addition to your own thoughts, what are the conditions we want to put on this application? In other words, this is an application that works if you do X, Y, and Z. And I think it's because oftentimes it takes more than one meeting. Board members just, start keeping notes about, what would possible conditions be. Because usually what happens is you examine an issue, you speak about the first meeting, and then it's resolved at the second meeting, and maybe you approve the plan the third meeting, and then no one's really remembering clearly what the discussion was about the first meeting about that issue. So if you keep track as you go along the way, it makes drafting and imposing conditions a lot easier.
So you mentioned engineering. So that stuff is at the applicant's expense. What about legal review? So we
legal document. Say it's a condominium project, and you want to make sure that most of what is in the condominium documents are not really your concern. But say there's going to be stuff about easement rights, open space. Those aren't going to be your concern. If you're expecting that, who's going to maintain, the culverts, where the water off the road drains.
Right.
So there's things like that. So yeah, legal review is at the applicant's expense as well.
Any peer review would be at the applicant's expense. The only thing I don't like, and I see towns do this all the time, is there are, science. There is art in science, and I see this. The one thing I see all the time is where a wetland scientist comes in and says, "I'm putting a flag here. This is wet." And someone goes out there and says, "I saw a little bit of ponding water on the other side of the flag." Let's hire someone to independently review. And my experience is generally that they might move one flag a foot over, but they might move another flag over another foot the other way. I hate that. Now there are cases when you might go out and say, "Geez, this guy missed, a pond in the middle of this field. How is that possible?" Where it just doesn't pass a straight face test. Then it's warranted. But legal, I've seen people have landscape architects hired, lawyers, traffic engineers are big, with bigger projects. So any kind of a peer review or review that, where you just don't feel like you're comfortable, you don't have the expertise, you can put it off on someone else to perform that review at their expense.
Yeah. And I agree with John, wetlands usually, you may get the information, but unless you go out there on the sidewalk and think someone missed it. Usually the wetlands scientists are pretty straightforward, you're right, the flags don't look that much. Let's see what else. And then, you know, obviously you're giving a butter notice to people at the beginning off of the list that is supplied by the applicant. Once in a great while, you know, there could be a mix-up where someone moved, or for some reason there was something didn't get delivered. And so it's always great to have a circulated sheet of who might be here. Because sometimes what will happen is the butters will learn about it, they'll come here, and if there's a failure to get noticed, and this happened twice over my years of practice, where someone took an appeal saying, I didn't get noticed, mm-hmm. and then you look, and lo and behold, they were there, talking at the meeting. And so, I've had judges who say, hey, you were there, you got noticed, you got actual notice, that's the best kind. I think that's always like a good practice thing to do with meetings. It goes into the file, and
the only thing I would say is our average crowd size is about 3 people.
3 people, right.
And Sarah probably knows everyone.
Right. So you can write down, if you know everyone is here, that's fine, because you just put it in at the top, who's there.
Okay. So
whether they speak or not.
So what happens if we get notifications sent back for some reason? Does it still say we attempted to notice, or?
Your obligation is to work off the taxes.
Update them. Your obligation is not to work off. They're the applicant.
The applicant, in fact, the town should not assist the applicant.
No, and I've sent back lists
right.
that are incomplete that I know are incomplete before.
Right.
To applicants.
That's fine.
That's good help.
But I know towns that prepare butters.
Oh, I haven't
and that
corrected
is horrible.
The list. I sent it back and said you need to update.
That's great. That's cool. But it's when towns and a lot of smaller towns do. They'll prepare the butters. If there's a mistake, you're in trouble.
Yeah.
You tell the party, here's the tax map. You know what the statute says. You figure out who your butters are.
Right.
Now, if you see they miss one, I would say, hey,
right.
You missed this guy. That's helpful. But it's their responsibility to send them. And I think if someone doesn't accept the return receipt, they get it back.
Yeah, your job.
Your job is to mail it.
So sometimes they come back and just say,
refuse, as much as
the address wasn't correct.
Right.
But a lot of times we don't get it till after the meetings happen.
Right.
Because the post office holds on to
right.
it and tries to deliver it.
Let the applicant know. And then, because they're the ones whose approval could be at jeopardy, and they'll talk with their lawyer and figure out what they need to do to cure the situation.
Okay.
And sometimes they're going to just run with it. Let's face it, 80-90% of no applications are never appealed. So it's only, you're trying to do it perfectly, but it only becomes a real issue if someone takes an appeal. And after a while, once you get past that 30-day jeopardy, you can't raise it anyway. But I agree with John's suggestion. If you see something, even though it's not your responsibility, help them out. Well, alert them.
Yeah. We do.
Right. You won't get in trouble by, helping them. Let's see. So minute taking is like an art. What you're trying to capture is what's said, the pertinent parts of what are said by the applicant, questions by the board, comments by the audience, and then how much detail you get. You want to get enough detail in there so that the board's decision is supported by the facts that were presented, so that if it ever gets appealed, a judge can, look at the meeting minutes and say, there's enough detail here for me to understand what the board did, and they talk about the pertinent facts, and obviously it meets the requirements of the ordinance and the regulations, so, we're going to uphold the board's decision. There are crazy lack of minute-taking details all around the state, and I think sometimes they're taking detailed quotes with how controversial the project is. And I'm not endorsing that or saying that's a bad thing, but I just know it happens. So it's, like I said, it's an art.
I think ours are great.
Well, I do have a writing degree, so.
Yeah, well, that's good, that's good. Yeah, and part of it is just the ear to know, because, you know, if they're taught, if you know that there's, for instance, an issue that's in contention, both from the board's perspective and the applicant's perspective, we're obviously giving a lot of detail.
Yeah, I mean, definitely since I'm going on 3 years, I think, doing this. I mean, I know a lot more now, and I know what to kind of report and what's not going to be pertinent.
Right. So here's my, like, annual favorite. Zoning ordinance interpretation by the planning board during subdivision and site plan review. I don't know how often that comes up, you know, but it is within your authority to interpret the ordinance. There are going to be questions from time to time. I'm going to gray. I gave you an example here, you know, for using language from your own ordinance, having to deal with a drug and alcohol, you know, residential treatment facility. I think you could come down on either side of that issue using that. That's exactly what happened to me in a case up in Tilton within the last year where they allowed adult treatment facilities, not a term defined by the ordinance. And someone came in with an alcohol and drug, you know, treatment facility, and it was it's a use permitted as a right in the agricultural residential zone, as it is. And so they wanted to put it into an existing building that didn't require the building to be done. But the threshold question was, is this what they call the adult recovery center? Is this adult recovery center a adult care facility? The board voted that it was, you know. Just using, but they could have come down probably on the other side. Although, quite frankly, I'd rather be defending the decision to find it did fall within that definition than saying it didn't, because there's a whole host of problems you get with residential facilities for people who have disabilities, which include people who are who are in recovery from drugs and alcohol. They are considered to be handicapped persons under the ADA, housing law. So, anyway,
but I don't think we've ever had anything where it's not
clear.
With
a yoga studio up on
Rock. Oh, that never, nothing ever happened of it.
Right.
No.
Right. Because they went to the select board and chair at the time said, no, don't bother. Right. I'll never allow it. He thought it was also a yogurt parlor.
Yogurt.
He said, what flavors are you going to have? Well, we all looked at him one.
Did he have an issue with use as far as place of worship in the mills when there was a Unity church down there?
Yes.
And how the wording was in the ordinance. And it was actually, there was a population number too that it caused concern because it got big, I think, at some point. But remember, it was a use issue we had.
It was, yeah.
How, and specifically your interpretation of how it was.
That wasn't a planning board issue.
We dealt with it. I remember we saw it.
Yeah,
I don't remember that.
Well, I'll tell you that, you know, I don't know, you may have some recollection. There is a federal statute that protects or gives basically federal protection to religious uses under federal law.
You made the right choice.
But this was actually ongoing when it kind of came before us.
No, I understand.
Or it was a current facility.
Right. What the federal law allows you to do is you can say, you don't want churches in, you know, the residential zone. But they're going to evaluate whether you allow similar places of assembly in that zone. And if you do, then you're discriminating. Mm-hmm. But if you don't, in other words, if you're consistent, then you can say, you know, you instead of thinking it's religious uses, you know, with a church or mosque or, you know, or a temple, think of it as places of assembly. And then just allow places of assembly in zones that they, you know, make sense. The other thing you can't do is you cannot condition the granting of those uses on a special permit. So you can't do a special exception, and you cannot do a conditional use permit. You can't make religious uses jump through hoops. So it's either black or white. It's permitted or it's not permitted. And that's a tricky issue. There's at least two towns in New Hampshire, one was west of Peterborough, that prohibited the church use, because I think they wanted their church on 101. They didn't want it there. And the town litigated that, and the attorney's fees and damages were unbearable. And so the federal law, when it bites...
Oh, the church on 101 was prohibited.
Exactly that. And when it bites bad. So you don't want to be on the wrong side of one of those decisions, too. And I've advised towns on that and say, listen, you've got a special exception here. Don't require this to come to people. Just write them a letter saying you're not going to require that for them. If this is a zone, we allow places of assembly. Tell them they're welcome to put their church. And of course, that happened in another seacoast town, and of course, it never materialized. But we don't know if they were fishing to fill the next church, hoping they were going to turn them down, or what the deal was. But, the alarms should go off if there's ever someone who's... You can bring them in for site plan review, just like you ever would have. But if you have, any questions arise out of church uses and permitting, give me a call quick. We sure can.
But that was one case where it was a use condition, and we dealt with that. But I mean, I've also seen the board make approvals with conditions that we set. One thing is like visual barriers, planting. I mean, along the Gagnon subdivision between the neighbors that recently bought that old beautiful house, the farm, and some other places where there were suggestions by developers to put X number of plants, and we reviewed it, and we said as a condition of our approval, we want more plants, more foliage, even between the budding industrial zones properties. But and we made that a condition of our approval, and I think that any decision the board makes needs to be something we need to be able to defend, because defending our decision is expensive. And if you're making approvals based on conditions that aren't necessarily of statute reasons...
Well, it depends. I mean, buffering and screening are things that you can require in your ordinance. I mean, that's not in your ordinance, in your planning board regulations. I mean, that's pretty straightforward stuff. Now, whether you put in that language to allow you to do that, I don't know, but you can have regulations like that. And I think buffering is particularly important when you have uses that are dissimilar, or you have structures that are of dissimilar sizes. So if you've got, the whole idea behind zoning oftentimes has been to separate commercial industrial uses and, residential uses. And lots of times, as John knows, I mean, the movement in the old days, you had special exceptions being granted by the, by the zoning board and variances, special exceptions or abuse that are permitted subject to conditions. Now the movement has been to do conditional use permits granted by the planning board. So there's kind of one-stop shopping. So you don't have the zoning board. There's the same supervision and control, but it's through a conditional use permit. So you've got one-stop shopping basically available for the applicant. So they come before the planning board. They need a special permit. It's not called a special exception anymore. It's called a conditional use permit. And that conditional use permit will have, you've got to jump through the same hoops that you would have had for a special exception. But then, conditions can be imposed. And that was, I think, it was fair to say, that was really done to streamline the process of development in New Hampshire.
Yeah.
To take kind of the zoning board out of the equation, so there would be one less stop to make. And the other thing was, let's face it, the planning board has more day-to-day experience with issues like buffering and setbacks and things like that, whereas the zoning board is usually... You interpreted the ordinance, we're giving you a variance, but they're not involved ordinarily in site plan issues or in subdivision issues.
Right.
So a lot of ordinances have made the jump towards conditional use permits to get at those types of issues that require some type of site adjustment by a board, and they make it the planning board. Continuing the application. That's just a practice point. if you always continue to a date specific and a time specific and a place specific, you never have to renotice. And so, and you know, sometimes it can get, you know, the engineer can't get the stuff done by the next meeting, so it's got to be 2 meetings from now. But there's nothing wrong with that, and yeah, that's
good. Can you only continue meeting at a meeting?
Yes, yes, yeah.
Like,
no, you can only do it at the end of the meeting.
Okay.
Well, not the end, but yeah, at the end, yeah, you do it at the end of the application at each.
Okay. There definitely have been times when, with the Bluen specifically, where he had to move his meeting to the next month.
Well, you can do it.
Yeah, but you never say us moving it and the other.
Well, you can do it, like for instance.
But it wasn't within a meeting.
You continue someone to next month.
Mm-hmm.
And then they write a letter to you a week before the meeting saying, we're not going to be ready.
Yeah.
That's no problem.
Okay.
You open up the meeting, you say we received a letter from Mr. Smith, it has to be continued, the butters are not happy, but at least they know that it's going to be the next meeting.
Okay.
That's no problem. The problem is you continue to the next meeting, and then the guy, you know, doesn't show, and you don't know what to do about continuance. Sometimes you'll continue to the next meeting anyway. But,
so at that point, can you terminate the application? So what if it's 2 meetings and they start
showing up? We've had that. If they don't show up for 2 meetings, people ask that from time to time, and they say, look, there's nothing wrong with you saying we're denying the application without prejudice to resubmit, because meanwhile the plaintiff's tried to contact the person and
yeah.
can't get anything out of them. And so we don't know what the family circumstance is. I mean, it could be someone died in the family, it could be a business trouble. You know, who knows what it is. So at that point, you just said you deny them without prejudice to resubmit.
And then they would need to start over.
And they start over.
Okay.
And the other thing is, it's not fair to the abutters.
Right. Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
People start losing
out.
Track. You know,
yeah.
Like, right. Where are we with this? They, you know, they didn't get notice of the original meeting.
Right.
So, if, you know, I think that's a good practice. And we do that.
Yep.
So one of the things we talked about was how to handle a butter or general. You know, project opposition, and you know, a lot of this, it doesn't happen that often, but it does come up, and then when it does come up, people can be, you know, really upset with the board sometimes, and so, and then they want to interrogate the board, you know, because you're causing this to happen, and look, it's a public hearing, you guys are here to listen. And you're not here to respond to the public because the board only speaks when it votes, you know, because you guys can have 5 different thoughts, all reasonable, about X, Y, or Z. And so it's not really productive to have individual members anyway, you know, entering into an exchange with the public. We're here to listen. The applicant is here to present its information. We're, you know, happy that you are here to comment on the information. All the questions must, if you have questions of the applicant, they go through the board, so that if the questions are legitimate, you can rephrase them and ask them of the applicant. A lot of just that common sense explanation stuff usually will diffuse how people, you know, when they're upset about stuff or when they're opposed about stuff.
We've had a few upset people.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Unfortunately, the practice has also been to allow exchanges between folks asking questions in the audience, board members, and applicants. So,
yeah,
it's good to hear that really shouldn't be happening.
Yeah, I think only because it's a respect issue.
Mm-hmm. It's not Miles who started that.
We try to.
We get to ask questions,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Of the applicant, but if members
right.
of the public
right.
make
you
comments
can ask
I
think,
on the project.
I'll bring up a specific example, and that was the Claude Gagnon subdivision.
Yep.
It was a subdivision next to an established neighborhood on a nice road in town. And the applicant did, I think, 3 duplexes and a single, something like
yeah.
that. Everybody was like, whoa, we didn't, you know. No one realized that, well, I think everybody knew, but sort of no one ever thought this was going to be developed in a duplex lots, and people were upset.
Right.
And so there was, you know, a lot of it was that again, people don't know what the role of the planning board is. They think we can sort of
you know, say no because they don't like it. And I think Miles, you did, I mean, we did, the board did a good job basically saying, this is what our zoning ordinance says. It's a little too little, it's too little too late to change it now. And the board did a good job putting conditions on this. Try to satisfy everybody. In the end, I think probably, you know, the applicant may not have been perfectly happy, the abutters may not have been perfectly happy, but we never heard any more of it. So I think the board did the best job we could. There was a little bit back and forth back then, but I almost think it, you almost had to allow that to make them,
right,
let them vent and make it.
Right, oh no, I agree.
Make them feel good.
You never want to shut people down.
It didn't go on too long.
It's the exchanges between that I will attempt to rein in and ask them if they can go to the hall and close the door if you want to continue.
Right.
Because
I think it's gotten much better as a compliment to you, but I also think that in the very beginning, as I recall, a topic that went through several meetings was line of sight issues. Mm-hmm. And that was something that was reviewed early in the process. And every time at subsequent meetings that come up, and it was voiced a lot by the public, this fits the regulations. It's been reviewed by people that review this. You know, we're not going to continue that discussion unless you take such channels that need be, because this is an approved, you know.
Well, and I wish John was here, because John was the one that kept bringing it up. In fact, I think John voted no on that application for no reason.
He wouldn't park his car.
But he wouldn't let it go. And
temporary road.
Yeah, and it was a tough one when you have someone that actually with a survey instrument measured something, and then you have a board member saying, it just doesn't feel right, you know. I think everybody else let it go.
I think it should have been, as I said, time being of the essence and helping the applicant. It fit, it was legal, it was legit, it was safe, as determined by people that's what they do.
Yep.
And I think that could have shortened the process for a meeting, if not more. Because there's a lot of back and forth on that. I'm just saying.
Yeah, no, you're
so conditions of approval and. You know, we talked about that a little bit, that we need to take notes as you go along, and then when you get to deliberations, you know, that's the time to discuss them. John obviously will be guiding you with the conditions of approval. You might have got input from maybe an engineer about what would be a good condition. You know, you can obviously, I think it makes sense to, amongst yourselves, you know, take the time to get the condition wording right, because once you approve it, it's there for all time. So, you know, don't feel rushed, you know, work on it with one another. It's always useful to explain why you're imposing the condition. And it's, there's a tendency, I think, you know, when we're all amongst one another, if someone says something that everyone agrees with, you nod or you think that. But sometimes it's really useful to have other members say, you know, I agree with what, you know, what John said or what Scott said, or, you know, or whatever the deal is, because that tells the judge that multiple members, you know, believe, you know, or went along with the sentiment. And it also lets the members of the public know and the applicant know, you know, the multiple members. So from my perspective, it's a much better record when a couple people speak up to explain on important points why they're going in one direction or why they're going in another direction. Because it gives more of a record.
And I think this board, again, does a good job of that. I'll sit and write things, and then a board member will review them, and the board votes on them collectively. So I think they do a good job. But I wanted to follow up on one thing that I don't think we're doing, is notices of decision. Can the minutes be the notice of decision? We don't have a whole lot of support, administrative support here,
right.
So I think Pat was.
Pat was, unbeknownst to
everybody.
Everybody doing them himself, and there's a template in the back of this.
Which is what I use.
That's what you
use.
So you're doing them now, Sarah?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think a notice of decision is a really good idea.
A formal notice of decision, rather than minutes.
Yeah, right.
Yeah,
right.
I agree.
I think a notice of decision should go to the applicant.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't like I took over duties. They sort of dealt to me. So, I'm happy to do it. I just didn't know that.
Yeah, I think it's, and if you ever want it, you know, if you want to see a variety of templates, just let me know.
Well, when I started doing them, I did a search, like, other towns.
Right. And
this, I have this already.
Right, And that's the best way to do it, yeah. I mean, and I think if you follow that, it gives enough detail. And then, of course, the minutes, you know, notice the decisions inform how the board got to, you know, where it got. But it's the minutes where, you know, you win and lose the cases, because there's got to be enough detail in the minutes to support the board's decision. So I can point to things and say, see, they're complaining that provision X, Y, and Z, you know, weren't met in the subdivision regulations. And I could say, no, you know, look at the plan, look at this, look at that, look at the comments, you know. So, yeah, I think notices of decisions are good. Because at the end of the day, also, I think people want to, it's like getting a report card. You take the class.
You pay for the application.
Exactly. You should get a notice of decision.
You get one. So you talk a lot about, I'm sorry to interrupt.
Just about, where do you file them? Do you put them in, like, the project?
Yeah, when the notice of decision is, and the board approves it, you know. But it gets mailed to the applicant.
Okay, so the board approves it at the next?
Well, no, I think what you can do is, you can circulate it to like the chair of the job.
Okay.
And just have them look at it and make sure it's accurate.
Because I've been signing them.
Yeah, and then you sign them.
I mean, ours are straightforward. We typical application, we might have three or four or five conditions.
Right.
I'm sure Sarah can put them right on the notice of decision.
Right.
Miles can review them.
Right, right, and then you mail it to the applicant for a copy of the plot.
Yeah.
That's it.
Should they go with the minutes, like, in, so the town clerk has the minutes too for the public? Should that notice of decision be put there to the public?
I don't think John knows our filing system, so that's, well, and I'm not trying to be funny, but.
No, it's hilarious.
We have a tough filing system, like.
Yeah, minutes are probably separate from others.
No, the minutes, so everybody's case gets a manila envelope, and that's all the documents go in that.
The notice of decision should be in the manila envelope.
Okay, so the minutes also are on file with the town clerk for the public to view.
I don't think the notice of decision.
No, notice of decision, well, first of all, notice of decision should be in the file, because when you're gonna go, if anyone wanted to come in and find it, right?
Yep.
You get the file folder for the case.
Yeah.
That's gonna be the last document that gets put in there.
Yeah, so they are now.
Right, right. They don't need to be with the meeting minutes.
Okay.
They're separate. Meeting minutes are usually separate, you know, than just as they are online, you know. But the file should have, you know, the file starts with, the application itself.
Supporting documents.
Supporting documents, the butters list, and then all the mail, you know, the copies of all the green cards that come back, all that kind of stuff. And then meeting minutes as they arrive, you throw them in there, but you don't have to. They should really have all the communications about the case, and the last thing is a notice of decision.
Okay. I mean, that's basically what's happening now.
Yeah.
And so now that we're doing that final step. Yep.
Applications and denials. As I said, it's something really had to go off the rails usually to get a denial. It just doesn't happen very often. But this, it's interesting. The statute that has to do with approvals and denials, the statute for denial says you must give a written explanation to someone for why you denied the case. There's nothing corresponding to that for approvals. But the court has, I mean, this legislature has responded to that. Because, there's just a long history of not enough information flowing back to the applicant, and probably a long history in some municipalities of just not denying projects for reasons that no one can understand. And so that's why the legislature has required that you must specify why a project has been denied, why an application is denied, and you must communicate that to the applicant. So if you're going to get that far, you know, my thought about application denials is I just tell my clients, say, listen, you know, if you get into deliberations and the sense is that this is not going to be an application that's going to be approved, you know, then what I usually suggest is, you know, continue it to another meeting, your deliberations to the next meeting. In the meantime, you know, the planner will contact me. I get an idea of what went on. I can look at the record, and I can make sure that if you're going to go in that direction, the things from the record, we're looking at the planning board meeting minutes, that you need to be talking about in the motion, so that any denial you make will be upheld. And the best denial is one where the attorney or the applicant reads it, understands it, and says, look, we're going to go correct these things. They're not going to go to court. They're going to go back to business. They're going to go put in an application that meets the requirements.
I had a great, years ago in the 90s, when Craig Benson was governor, I think, he and some of his buddies owned a bunch of lands in Greenland, where the golf course was going on, and he was developing that. I was the planner in Greenland. Hmm. And he was doing maybe a 50 or 60 lot subdivision, and it emptied onto, it was a strange, I think it was, I can't remember what road it was, it doesn't matter, but I think it was Winnicott Road. And it was 50 feet of frontage on Winnicott Road. And for a mile or two in one direction, a mile or two in the other direction was Stratton. Peter Laughlin, who's probably the best land use lawyer in the state.
Right, he's perfect.
Terrific. Was the attorney. Both he and I advised, the town's attorney, both he and I advised him, said, it's not the grounds for denial. They're like, well, we can't. It's not fair for us to have to run our school buses and our town trucks over a mile of Stratton Road in Stratton to get to a town road in the middle of nowhere. And I said, well, you can't, that's not grounds. Yeah, they denied it. Well, sure enough, you know, it gets appealed. And then they listen to Peter, and they said, I can't defend this thing. I told you not to deny in the first place. So we've never gotten even close to that point, but I agree with John that if there ever is something you want to deny, I would recommend, if John or another attorney, make sure they support it, because they're the ones that are going to defend the damn thing. And it's not easy to deny an approval anymore.
Yeah, what I always tell boards that are going that way is, give them an approval they don't like.
With a list of conditions.
Yeah. In other words, not in a penalizing way.
Right.
But in other words, work towards an approval they don't like. I've got an appeal going up before the Superior Court later this month out of Plymouth. And so there's 149 acres. It's a family to settle it. They're carving off 50. And they had wetlands delineation done or near the new lot line. They want to put a driveway in. So you got a frontage lot, and then all the other 100 acres, or whatever it is in the back. So they need to kind of get a driveway in there for like a woods road, stuff like that. They put the driveway right through allotments. Now, the town denied the application on that basis. And so no one contacted me until after the deed was done. And my advice, I think, in a similar set of circumstances, although I do think this is defendable, but my advice would have been said, tell them that it's approved, subject to moving the road over there. In other words, rather than a denial, give them approval, but just tell them they have to move the road. Yeah. So, and we'll, you know, I think we can prevail on the case, but like you said, give them the approval they don't want. They wanted the road right where it was. It didn't need to be right where it was. You know, it was stupid to be. It was going to be impassable half the year right where it was. But anyway. Okay, so recording the plan, performance guarantees, needs and fees. So the rules of procedure can address some of these things, you know, at the end, you know, where you require an applicant, you know, to bring the plan. So county suggestion, county's got to have a Mylar. You know, Stratford County, you can be paper or a Mylar. You know, they don't care. But what you want to make sure still is that they're all kind of persnickety about how much detail. You know, this is the wonderful thing about layers and a computer now and a CAD machine. You can put so much stuff on a paper, it's ridiculous.
Yeah.
But the registry hates that. And so what we think the best practice is to work in your regulations is you tell the applicant's engineer or the surveyor, they know ahead of time, we got to go get the plan pre-approved for recording by the registry. Which just means they swing it by the registry, you got people get out their glances and they look at it, they make sure it's outside the margins, you know, inside the margins and all that stuff. And then, or if they see something they don't like, they tell you. Which is much better than the plan being handed to John or being handed to you, and you go to the registry and they say, I'm sorry, this, and this is unacceptable, you know.
So I gotta stop you.
so we don't record site plans. We don't record anything.
Most.
So it's a it's a horrible practice.
Why don't you subdivision plans?
No, we sign them and they give them back to the
applicant. Okay, right.
That's so, and which causes another big problem, right? Because some of them never get recorded.
That's exactly it. Yeah.
So years ago we recorded and then we stopped and we're in.
So we need a new.
What's that?
We need a new practice.
Yeah, the practice.
And it's expensive. I will tell you, I used to do it for two or three towns, and in Rockingham County, I think Kathy Stacy's still the registrar. She's horrible. I would be 30% at best getting stuff recorded, and it was, you know, you go from Portsmouth to Brentwood, you know, three times, it's 6 hours.
This is why you get the
so, well, or you charge them, you know.
Oh, no, of course.
If it's not recordable, you know, I mean, I don't know what a trip from here to the registry is, but I bet you it's an hour round trip.
Yeah, I think, you know. Yeah.
By the time you get done screwing around.
Oh, well, yeah, I was going to say, by the time you're finished, then I better get an hour.
It's an hour. So, this has always been a tough one for us, because we just had a situation where someone, they never recorded their plan. You call me, I think, and ask me about it.
So deal has to be you report. You have to report.
Okay.
You can't be giving it to someone, because then, you know,
the town.
Well, there's a couple of things. One is they could modify it.
They could change it.
Well, that's the other thing.
And that's why I can't believe it's still have Mylar.
Right. No. I mean, there are some certain people who are now deceased that, you know, have been known for those things. And, you know, they've been random, and we won't say who their names are. But in any event, you know, you should be recording. You should be getting, first of all, you don't want to, if the subdivision is a road, you don't want a road deed. you can have a sample road deed just to make sure that they draft it right, but you don't want to be recording the road deed, because you're not going to accept the road until it's built and it's been signed off on. But you may very well want drainage easements on private property. So if there's going to be, you know, if your engineer is saying, I need drainage here and I need drainage here, you're going to get those deeds up front now, when that plan, and put that on when that plan goes on record, because otherwise you're chasing those homeowners. And, you know, meanwhile that's a petunia bed, and, you know, So you have to get the drainage easements, you have to get you know, culverts, all those kinds of improvements that your road agent's life is made easier with, you know, during, you know, plow and raining and the spring cleaning season. I think you need, if you have lot line adjustment plans, you have to not only record those, but you need the deeds from the two people who are adjusting their lot line. A lot of people think that when they go in for a lot line adjustment plan, once you approve it, it's done. And so they'll go record the plan themselves after they exchange some money, and then they never do a deed. And so, but they then treat their property as if it's been divided.
Right.
And then 30 years later, someone moves to Florida, and the other person passes away, and then the people are like, I can't sell my lot because
yes.
There's nobody on this. So on lot line adjustments, you got to have the deeds. You don't need that on subdivisions to the house deeds, you know, because they're going to all be sold out to other people.
Right.
You need the performance bond, you know, for the roads. You know,
we put that in the Board of Selectmen's. They handle that.
Right, but
we're required.
But you need to know. But before the plan is recorded, you need to know that the performance guarantee in an acceptable form, in the right amount, has been received by the selectmen. You don't go put that plan on record until you know you have that, because as soon as the plan's on record, they can transfer lots, or they can sell the full site. And if there's no performance bond in place, how are you going to guarantee that something's going to get built? I'd be happy to help you with, kind of drafting up, even if it's, you know, work with John, just a set of revisions to either your bylaws or your regulations that address these things.
Do we know why we stopped recording them?
It's always been a personnel issue. I don't remember, but years ago we did it and then we stopped. I don't know, Miles. I don't know.
Since I've done it, we haven't.
Well, you can charge fees for all these things, and there are going to be recording fees. And so, you know, my real estate paralegal gets stood off the top of her head with the recording fees on for everything. And we can, you know, provide you with that and update you with that. But the, you know, and, you know, I mean, if you have a real problem with someone getting in the registry, I mean, we can have someone do it for you, the whole expense could be borne by the applicant.
Yep.
You know, another thing is, that should give everyone the assurance that then it gets done right, you know.
No, I think we just gotta figure out how to work, we're probably talking about three or four plans a year.
Right, right.
So it's not, we don't have a high volume of plans being recorded, it's just, I think we stopped doing it when we just didn't have the support staff to do it, and that's what I recall, I mean, it's been years since we recorded the plan, but it's awkward.
And then there were, you know, this, you get the whole vested rights statute, which is RSA 674-39, which says that, you know, vesting begins after the signature and recording of the plan. So what happens if you don't record the plan? How do you measure when the vesting period begins? Then you have an enforcement statute under 674, I think it's 30. I think it's 40 or 41, where you can revoke it's 676-4A, you can revoke a plan, right? Well, you know, there's no hammer if the plan's not recorded. In other words, if they haven't done the things that they're supposed to be doing out there, it's a great hammer to say plan revocation. That gets the bank's attention, that gets everyone's attention, but if the plan hasn't been recorded in the first place, you're denying yourself a hammer that you might need to use if someone's misbehaving. So recording is really important. And then the one thing I didn't talk about on this is, you know, one of the most important things, this is particularly for you, it's important for big projects, and it's also important for projects that happen to occur at the end of an economic expansion, where all of a sudden the bottom falls out of the barrel and you gotta, you know. So, and that's it. That is, when is a project substantially complete for purposes of vesting? You have the right under the statute to tell people when that is. And I think that's actually a really good discussion to have with applicants. Figure out what level of improvements shown on the plan will vest them. This is really important in subdivisions, you know?
Yep.
So, I mean, is it when you put, you know, the road into, you know, into binder course? Is it when you, you know, I mean, there should be a, you know, you build four house lots. I mean, the law says that there's an absolute measure, and I think it was $200,000 worth of public expenditures where you're going to be vested. But I think it's better you guys have a discussion with an applicant at the end, just as you get to the end of the project and say, okay, let's talk about vesting. Because and that protects them from changes. It also, you know, so if there are changes in the regulations, they're going to be subject to the rules of the game that they apply to when they come in, which is entirely fair. It also protects them from people who want to challenge whether the rest of the project is vested. To have an express discussion about what's the milestone is a good thing to do.
So if a project is approved, and then for 10 years they don't do anything,
yeah.
And subsequently zoning regulations change,
right.
They're not vested, then. They haven't done
right.
anything.
Yes, that's right. That's right. Whereas, say, for instance, usually what you have, the problems with vesting come up when it's the go-go years of real estate development.
Sure. Well, I think about like on Arch Street in Dover.
Yeah.
There's that
Friesian
field, somewhere they tore down a couple of houses.
Right. It's what's the guy's name?
Oh, is it really?
What's his name?
Brand.
The other guy.
Atkins?
Oh, I didn't know that. Well, anyway, that is there's a connection.
I mean, we had this problem.
It's for sale, by the
way. We had this problem
in 1989 when I was in Hudson. We had developers all over the place.
Sure, yeah.
Approved, some recorded, some not recorded, some just barely started. Boom. The FDIC came in and take off half the banks in New Hampshire. And there was no movement for like 3 or 4 years. The same thing happened, you know, in 1996. I mean, in 2006 with the recent thing. So, you know, so
it's a little different here, John, in the sense that our subdivision activity is generally small scale, five or six lots, and we have not seen a zoning change that would affect vesting in a long time. But it's still a good practice to have.
Right,
and if we did have the failed zoning project that was,
had a 15 lot before I got on the board, a 15 lot subdivision on. Wentworth Street, the Chinburg.
Oh, right, right. Yeah.
So, but,
yeah.
Right. So it's just a good decision, and I'm actually a big believer in you don't need to have a high bar. It's just whatever the bar is,
it should be
make it visible.
Yeah, so that everyone can agree what it is.
We're not trying to punish people or make it difficult. We just want to have it clear so that the rules of the game are known.
So, for example, the Gagnon subdivision is now a year and a half since that got approved, and there's been no visible sign of activity. Like, at what point?
Is the plan recorded?
No,
I don't know.
Okay, so there are. So, ordinarily, for instance, this will come up when the plan is recorded. They post a bond. The bond has, you know, like a year, and then all of a sudden, suddenly the bond expires, right? And that's one of the reasons when you can revoke the site.
Oh, okay.
So you contact the guy. When the bond expires, you say, hey, you know, there's no bond here. You better get this in. And if they say no, or even worse, say there's a frontage lot, and we got four houses around the cul-de-sac. They build the frontage lot, and then they start to put the road in. They're halfway through. There's a lot of drainage issues next to this lot. The bond expires. I mean, that's a problem, you know. And if the plan's recorded and you've got the bond, then you're all set. But if the bond expires, then all your leverage is with the recorded plan. And you can threaten to revoke the plan, and that's usually your only leverage to get them back in.
So there's one of the breakdowns in our system, because we don't know whether or not the plan was ever recorded.
Yeah.
And no bond was issued because they never came to the select board to talk about building a road.
Well, the other thing you can do is
I don't remember the conditions, but I'm sure we put some sort of surety or requirement for the board or something. No, nothing's changed in the zoning ordinance to prevent
that.
Right.
So that's really a moot point.
Well, I think the big problem is the big problem we always ran into was the bonds went away because the banks didn't want to extend them because the land was underwater and the economics didn't support the project. Mm-hmm. And there were tremendous pressure from FDIC to have their bank reserves higher. Mm-hmm. And every time they give a letter of credit, it's drawn against their bank reserves, so the bank reserves go lower. That's what got all these banks in.
But I mean, potentially the subdivision on Clement Road, if it could be in jeopardy if they don't have any movement in the next year or so, if the planning board decides we want to put an amendment for zoning on the town warrant to say that there's no duplexes
right.
In that residential zone, right?
Or change, yeah, sure,
right.
Absolutely.
I'm not suggesting we're
change,
trying
right.
to do that to them, but I mean,
yeah,
it could be
a
jeopardy.
Just
no.
As an example,
sure,
because that's one that is in, that I drive by and see there's
still
no activity.
Right.
You'd want to be in the business of recording the plans and not worried about those things happening.
Yeah.
I mean, it got so bad at Hudson after the late 90s that when things started to turn around 2003, 2004, because then you had the dot-com bubble, which burst in 2002. And around 2004, 2005, stuff started to come back again. We actually started to conduct public hearings on plans that had been approved but not recorded, and ones that had been recorded but not done. And we started just revoking them. And half the property owners never showed up. And then another half came in and contested it. Some of them we let go forward, but they had to put money up and things like that. But I mean, there were a lot of projects that were just sitting there. And, you know, and our fear was that our regulations had changed a lot in the interim because of the lessons we learned.
Sure.
And we didn't want, we weren't trying to screw anyone. We were just trying to figure out, is this a viable project or not? And if there's no one coming forward, we want to get them off the books. And that's what we did. And someone else walked on.
Okay.
Now the fun part. Questions about anything?
I have a question about fees. So in here, the checklist said, so when an applicant submits an application, you collect fees for noticing and what?
Well, there's an application fee, you know. Some towns have review engineer fees that they, you know, do on a per lot basis, or they may do on a site plan basis, square footage basis, or they may say, send the plan to our engineer, he'll give us an estimate of what it costs, and then you, that part of the application, so you have the application fee, which is usually a flat fee, you know, $250, $300, something like that. And then there's the review fee that relates to the engineer, and then there's the mailing fees, you know, for notice. Those are usually, anything else?
It would be the public notice and the mailing fee.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's it.
So.
And then on back, you're gonna have recording fees.
Okay, so when are we expecting recording fees?
No, you can get them later.
I was, that should be a condition, if we're gonna do that, and I would love if we did that, to make it a condition of the approval. And I don't know how you set the fee, because there's gonna be a per plant, per page fee.
Well, it's actually already in the plan schedule.
Is it, but we should at least check with the registry to see if it's still, the number's still good. And then there needs to be a shuttling fee, you know, whatever it is, I mean, selecting, whatever, whoever's doing it.
Yeah.
You know, an hour and a half of their time, or whatever's reasonable, you know, per trip.
Okay.
So.
So at this point, the town recording fee is 50 per page, plan page.
You just gotta call the registry and ask them if that's good. But we don't lose money.
Well, and there's other things, there's L chip, there's, I mean, there are.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
Any, yeah, you gotta pay the L chip fee.
Call my paralegal, Stephanie Guy.
Okay.
On Thursday or Friday, she's in Portland, I think tomorrow. The number's 778-0686, actually, she's remarried, Stephanie Carty, I'm not gonna say call any of that. C-A-R-T-Y. And just tell her who you are, and just, she'll just tell you, you know, who's in charge or anything like that. She'll just tell you the fees, and what, the big thing is the identity, so you get all on the list.
Yeah.
And she'll tell you recording fees and stuff.
What I used to do when I did a lot of recording was, I would just tell the applicant to give me a blank check made out to the town, and then, because then I, well, and I, it wasn't, I'm not trying to, it wasn't, because I would, you know, I wouldn't know what the fee was.
Right.
And then I would fill it out and tell them what it was, and then, but again, if you gotta make two trips, then you can ask them for another, you know, $75 check for your time, or, I don't know how you handle that, you know, but.
Well, that's where having them pre-run by the registry.
Right, right.
Having them check is actually gonna be very beneficial.
It really makes sense, it benefits everyone to do that.
We deal with the same, a handful of local engineers and surveyors that have good relationships, so it's not, we don't get a lot of guys from Manchester that have never done work for the Stratford County Registry of Deeds, so I think the people that we do, that do permitting here have, I don't think we'll have a problem.
Sure.
But it's still a good idea.
Well, in that case, maybe if you don't require it upfront, then you have to put a real appeal period if we have to go back.
Sure.
You know.
Whatever, yeah.
But generally, in collecting the fees, from the applicant's side of it, where they paid the town fees to perform some of the services that the town may contract to have performed on this application to move forward.
Right.
That should be every fee that the town anticipates having to pay out to service providers, outside service providers for review, et cetera. But there was some confusion, some about, and maybe you're more familiar with this, where applicants were then required to pay directly outside service providers in some cases for their service.
This just came up with the blue note.
Yep.
We paid, Jeff paid a fee, then we asked, Aaron LaChance, I can't.
Oh, Oil and Tanner.
Oil and Tanner Review. Jeff paid him directly, or them directly, I believe.
And also Jay Stevens.
And then civil consultants fee exceeded the town's fee, I don't know by how much, but then whatever he exceeded it by, he had to pay that too. We could have said, okay, the fee is gonna be $5,000, and we'll give you a refund, but that works out fine, because without, you know, without the approved plan, he's got nothing, so if he doesn't pay it.
Yeah, they pay an escrow fee.
Yeah.
And it's a condition of any.
Right, and, but shouldn't, as far as control of the fees of the applicant, shouldn't all money be directed to the town?
I think,
and then the town disperses for.
Yes, because the statute.
And generally.
Company A needs to review, and company B.
The statutory authority.
It still should be collected and controlled by the town.
The statutory authority.
In an escrow account for every anticipated fee, even though they could send the check directly, it still should go to the town to then dole out For proper taxation.
Yeah, to ensure that it's actually.
Well, it generally does. I mean, Blumenbill is a little bit different just because he exceeded the fee, but.
The statutory authority to collect the fee arises, it's given to the planning board. So all the stuff should go through the planning board and the escrow account, because there's no statutory authority on behalf of an engineering review company to collect the fee. They only, it flows through the town. So you want to go through the town, you also want to have a record of how the money came in and came out. You have to detail all that, because you have to provide the county. And if the fees are paid directly between the firm, you can't satisfy the auditor, or you can't satisfy other people that the accounts are accurate.
And you're in agreement that it should never be a case where an applicant pays outside providers, ever. It should, even if it seems like a accounting nightmare, they should accept X fee, the town should accept X fees and pay out X fees and all the documentation.
I mean, I think the way it worked in Blumen was fine. I think you're making a mountain out of a molehill.
This isn't criticizing, this is just saying that.
But you want the town to set an escrow fee for every, it just, this isn't Portsmouth, this isn't Dover. I mean, if this happens once a year.
Yeah, you do, because people lose their jobs when money gets mishandled. And if you have.
But John, this is a case of where the engineer's review fee exceeded our application fee. We said pay the bill.
I understand. We're talking about best practices. We're not saying that people were bad because something was done differently once. We're saying, okay, we've thought about this, you're going forward. We need to have an escrow account because people need to be accountable. If it looks like, I mean, the way that this is the, it's not unusual to have the estimate exceed. If you set the estimate too low, it's going to be exceeded. So when Jones and Beach, or whoever the review engineer is, listen, I got another $2,300 in review fees, then the town just sends an email to the so-and-so and says, post another $2,300 with the planning office or the selectman's office, because we've been informed that the review fee was.
I just think that, stressing the importance, and not a molehill, but that if we're going to follow accountability to the letter of the law, to where we have to defend the decision on such, that even though it may be a little bit more effort and tedious, I think, the town should contact the applicant and say, I'm sorry, this fee's going to exceed this much more, and we need to collect that.
Yeah, usually what the regulations say.
Yeah,
the regulations say, usually in towns that, have regulations, it says a sentence in there, it's a throwaway line. It says, if the fees incurred exceed the amount posted, the applicant has the obligation to supplement, the escrow account.
I'm not arguing that, I'm arguing how it's paid. And I just think to give, I think we're beating a dead horse, but to give the town a check so the town can pay a bill is sort of ridiculous.
No, you have to do that way, because the only authority to collect the fee in the first place is by the escrow account. And the statute says you have to keep an accounting of it. You have to. So this isn't like a choice matter.
Well, it's the only way to ensure that it actually gets.
It's done. Right.
Dispersed.
Right.
I mean.
And we don't want to set up anyone for criticism for not having followed the law when it comes to money. You're volunteers. You just don't want to be there. So you have a set of procedures that is consistent. You can call over to other towns, planning boards, and say, how do you do this? If you have questions and. And you're right, at the end of the day, the last condition on the plan is, all fees have to be paid before the plan is signed. So, you check, are all the fees paid first? They're all paid, then you sign the plan. They're not paid, no signature. No tiki, no laundry.
Any other questions?
Well, I mean, the section, especially around the town, really should be recorded in the plan. I don't know how or why we've gotten the practice of
not doing that, but.
I wish I could tell you my.
Expediency.
Oh, listen, listen, you're not alone.
I want to work on that.
I mean, I know all kinds of towns that.
Yeah, they might work.
But they.
The redevelopment of Cumberland Farms, it was a tight site.
Right.
There were just silly things like buffering was important, landscaping. It would have been helpful, I think, to have that in a record and registry. So if anybody ever says, hey, you know, what would the planning board approve, you could find.
Yeah. I don't know why it's like.
Well, most towns, a lot of towns that I work with do record them, but Rollinsford has always had the position that we don't record site plans.
Lots of towns I know don't record them, lots of other towns do, I don't know why they've chosen not to.